I thought, you know, I was definitely inspired by, you guys ever heard of H.H. Holmes?
The architect?
Not exactly.
The porn star? With the really big penis? Yeah,
the porn star?
No, that was John Holmes.
Oh, you knew that really quick.
Is it the wrestler? Triple H?
No, that's Hunter Hearst Helmsley.
Oh, okay.
See, H.H. Holmes was the very first serial killer in United States history.
Really?
In 1893, he started construction on the World's Fair Hotel in Chicago, Illinois, which is now known as the Murder Castle.
Yeah, that's right. They were doing the 1894 World's Fair happened in Chicago, and it was it's like where they unveiled the Ferris wheel, I think was the first time they did that. And there was a
first funnel cake.
When he designed the hotel, he turned the entire interior of the hotel into a living game. There were never-ending hallways. There were blast charges that were behind mirrors, behind pictures. There were rooms that were actually sealed gas chambers. So people would check into the hotel and find themselves in a never-ending maze. They couldn't get out.
They were
gassed. They were shot. They were bludgeoned. Their bodies were soaked in acid baths, and the remains almost completely liquefied.
Whoa.
Yes. Yeah.
This is in Chicago, Illinois?
Chicago, Illinois.
And it was the World Fair's Hotel?
The World's Fair Hotel. It was such a big hotel that it took up almost an entire city block in downtown Chicago. That's how large of a hotel it was.
How many people would be staying at this hotel at any given time?
The hotel only had three floors. The third floor actually was originally a storage area, and then he began construction on that third floor in late 1893, telling his investors that he was expanding for the World's Fair. That's the reason why they were dubbing that hotel to be the World's Fair Hotel. What he was actually doing was creating another floor in which guests would come in and be trapped amongst the never-ending hallways that would lead them right back into detrimental situations that he had set up for them. So it was almost like a mouse's maze.
And I heard he also had easily accessible chutes to drop bodies down to furnaces.
Yes.
So, like, instead of garbage chutes, it had body chutes.
Well, and in the basement of the hotel, he had furnaces and he had acid baths. And so that's what he was doing, is he would take the dead bodies and he would either incinerate them, or you can only incinerate so many bodies in a day before the smoke becomes very evident. And so that was in the situation where he decided to start using acid baths because it was less conspicuous.
Isn't it true that he was getting rid of some of the bodies by, like, basically getting rid of all the flesh on them and just selling off the skeletons to medical schools at the time, because skeletons and human cadavers were in great need for medical students training doctors?
Right. And actually, he was a doctor himself, and that's why he was able to do that.
Really?
Yeah. He graduated from the University of Michigan in 1884. Most of his activity was never questioned because he was actually regarded as a doctor.
Wow.
Yeah, so okay. Did they ever catch this guy? Like, what the fuck? Like,
yeah, he was actually apprehended in 1894, and he was brought to trial and hanged.
Whoa.
All right.
Right.
Well, how many people do they think he killed?
He confessed to 27 murders.
What?
After the course of his execution, they linked it to more than 200.
Jeez.
Yeah, but some of the people he said he killed were still living. So he kind of weaved his own web of lies so that maybe people can give him credit and say, oh, I don't know if he did that.
Right, but
he was a master manipulator.
Sure, but the way they came to the number of 200 was by the number of people who checked into the murder castle that were never heard of again.
Interesting.
Well, okay, let's say you have a hotel. Wouldn't you say 200 people who checked in never checked back up at the hotel again? Or do you mean, like, they were killed?
Well, they didn't have Yelp back then, so you couldn't really, like,
gotcha.
Post a Yelp review and be like,
totally was killed.
Never totally left. Never going here again. In an acid bath right now.
Lame.
Negative one star.
So how did they end up catching him eventually?
The insurance companies were pressing to prosecute him for arson.
He was also, like, trying to fraud life insurance companies,
yes.
Right?
Yeah, exactly. So he left Chicago in July of 1894 and went to Fort Worth because he had invested some properties there from previous people that he had defrauded life insurance policies from.
Oh.
So that's where he ended up, you know, going. So he was trying to actually construct another castle, another murder castle, in Fort Worth, Texas.
He's looking to expand?
Yes, yes.
Make it a chain?
Yeah. And so, and basically what he was doing was same thing he did in Chicago, is he was swindling suppliers out of the materials to build the hotel or to build out the castle with, and then just never paying
just
on any of his
borrowing
desk.
On killing credit him. For
exactly.
all the lumber
right.
and labor
right.
and.
But like, you can have a free room at the hotel any night you want, sir.
And, so, and that's how he kept it, you know, because I mean, you can't build these things and not have people eventually go, why are you putting a flamethrower behind a mirror? So he would not pay people. He would go through several different contractors to keep what he was doing secret. Because otherwise people would eventually go, okay, really, you're not supposed to have a saw under a bed.
The noise helps me sleep.
The white noise.
So his original arrest, it was for selling mortgaged goods in St. Louis, Missouri.
Okay.
Pawn shops, pawn brokers, or...
He was selling goods that were not paid. So basically, if you had a mortgaged good, what that means is that you don't really own it. You bought it on loan or you bought it on a line of credit.
Gotcha.
And he was taking these items from people who, you know, he'd either crossed or done business with or whatever, and was trying to resell them again before they were actually paid off to the original loan.
Gotcha.
That's what he was arrested for. And then, you know, promptly bailed out of jail. But while he was in jail, he struck up a conversation with a convicted outlaw named Marion Hedgepeth, who was serving a 25-year sentence.
Jesus.
Holmes had concocted a plan to swindle an insurance company out of $10,000 by taking out a policy on himself and then faking his own death.
Ooh.
Holmes promised to pay Hedgepeth a $500 commission in exchange for the name of a lawyer who could be trusted. Holmes was directed to a young St. Louis attorney by the name of Jephthah Howe. Howe was in practice with his older brother, Alfonso Howe, who had no involvement with Holmes or any of the fraudulent activities, you know, at all. Nevertheless, he planned his plan to fake his own death failed when the insurance company became suspicious and refused to pay.
Probably because he was just arrested.
Yes.
And now he's cooking up something with an insurance policy. Yeah.
So, his co-conspirator, the guy's name was Pietzel. When the previous attorney said, hey, we're not going to pay on it, the two of them just moved on and they started finding other attorneys and other insurance companies they were trying to swindle. And when it became clear to Holmes that this guy was not going along with what he wanted to do, he chloroformed the guy and killed him as well.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
right.
Well,
he took out a policy on his partner and then offed him?
Correct. Yes.
Wow. Yeah. Who hasn't thought about doing that? Right. Come on.
So he took out a policy on Pietzel, killed him, and was continuing to collect on that.
Oh, pretzel.
Right. That's what started getting the IRS's attention, and the United States government started figuring out, where's all this money coming from, and why is this guy collecting on the insurance policies of all these people?
Right. Mm-hmm.
And it basically led them into the funnel, which was H.H. Holmes.
And what year was this at?
This was in 1894.
And that's when he was caught?
Yes.
And the World's Fair was 1894?
It was 1894.
Really?
But he started construction on the hotel in 1893 to have it ready for the World's Fair.
What else can you tell us about this guy?
Okay. So this is where the story gets a little spooky.
Okay.
Because the rest was just normal, just workaday boilerplate stuff, you know?
Compared to what I'm about to tell you, yes.
Okay.
Okay. So in 2006, mm-hmm. his great-great-grandson, H.H. Holmes' last name was actually Mudgett.
That made me want to kill people.
His firstborn son was Robert Mudgett, who became an accountant and was actually the city manager for Orlando, Florida. 2005, his great-great-grandson inherited all of the belongings of H.H. Holmes.
Does the guy go by Mudgett or Holmes?
He goes by Mudgett.
All right, nice.
Yes. He's actually an attorney in the Midwest, in the Illinois state of Illinois.
Okay.
So when he inherits all of the belongings of his great-great-grandfather, he was intrigued by, you know, handwritten journals and letters to home and books and all of these other things. And so he's going through them. And as he starts going through these books, he finds a detailed plan that he had written out where he was going to evade his own execution by tricking a less than sharp inmate that was in jail with him into taking his spot on the gallows and being hung instead of him.
Really?
So he might have faked his own death?
So he starts into the investigation on, is H.H. Holmes actually buried in H.H. Holmes's grave? That was step one. Step two is, as he starts going through these journals, he finds a series of journals that were written between 1888 and 1891, before the construction of the murder castle. Mm-hmm. In those journals, he is living in London, England at the time.
Okay.
And in those journals between those dates, he details the murder and dismemberment of multiple prostitutes in the city of London.
Really?
That all coincide with the murders that were the Jack the Ripper murders.
When did he graduate? Oh, no. When did he graduate from medical school?
In 1884.
So he was an actual doctor?
Yes, he was an actual doctor.
And that would fit the Jack the Ripper profile.
Well, correct. I don't know, because what I was looking at, there was one detective who did not think it was a surgical hand. It looked like it was a layman just hacking into throats.
But correct. There's also theories, though, that it was a basic knowledge of anatomy, so it could have been someone who was just skilled with butchering animals as well.
Correct.
Truth.
Yes.
Okay, so maybe he's Jack the Ripper. What is this about the burial site?
Right. So his great-great-grandson actually petitioned the state of Illinois to have his remains exhumed. So the body was in an unmarked grave, so they had to follow actual records from the time to figure out exactly where in this cemetery he was buried.
Weird.
So they found the spot, headstone.
It was like a pauper's grave.
Exactly.
It was like 148, Dr. H.H. Holmes.
Most serial killers, people like Bundy and John Gacy, all of them are buried in unmarked tombs because they don't want people going to those tombs and like worshiping these people there. Right.
It's like a serial killer treasure hunt.
Yeah.
You know.
So they...
It's an Easter
egg
hunt for...
There you go.
For killers.
So they found the spot where he was to be buried at. They broke ground and they dug down 6 feet and the shovels hit a wooden casket.
Like you would expect.
Exactly.
Yeah. Right.
So they clear the ground around and they pull it out. They open it up. It's empty.
Oh, no.
There's nothing in it.
That's not good. Yeah.
So immediately they think, okay, maybe there is some truth behind this. We have an empty coffin here that's supposed to be H.H. Holmes. They do sonar on the area, and they found another mass that was 12 feet or 6 feet below that. So
like they did in Jurassic Park when they find a skeleton at the beginning. They're like, thump the ground, and you see this.
Bingo. Dino DNA.
So a total of 12 feet underground, they find a cement sarcophagus because he had specifically asked to be buried in cement.
Really?
Yes.
That's
why. Weird. Don't know.
So they take the coffin
so
out.
So they pull it out. His body is bones. All of the soft tissue had eroded off of it, except for, of course, the clothing he was wearing and his mustache for some reason.
What?
Awesome.
Mustache was intact, no other flesh on the body, but his brain was completely intact and preserved inside of his skull.
Because it was connected to the mustache.
It's all one unit.
I don't know.
They're connected.
How can you have a mustache if you don't have any lips?
I don't know. That's it.
The mustache does not need lips. The lips are lucky to have the mustache.
Thank you.
So they do DNA testing and find out that indeed that is H.H. Holmes. He did not evade his execution date. He was hung. He was hanged. And that side of the story is settled. The question would be now, and there's really no way to narrow it down, but based on his travel logs and based on his diaries, he was in London between 1888 and 1891 when the Jack the Ripper killings took place. So there is the possibility that H.H. Holmes was not only America's first serial killer, but he was also Jack the Ripper.
When you think about it, it makes a little bit more sense because it's almost like, what would a serial killer that normally does what he does in his hotel do on his vacation?
Yeah,
you know,
exactly.
Kind of stretch it out a little bit. Just, you know, there's like basically they were like the dead prostitutes were like the zip line for serial killers, you know, just something a little crazy. Oh, I would never normally do this. I'm just gonna leave this body right here on the ground. Woo!
There's some constable standing around going, "Well, bloody Americans on holiday."
So let me get this straight.